Here comes the sun. Doo 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 doo. Huh, just kidding. It's February in Canada. Although today it still is kind of sunny compared to other days in February. But I just wanted my YouTube commenters that say I sound like Kim Kardashian to hear my singing voice. So let's talk vitamin D. True story. My best friend lives in those places that you visit on vacation. The Pacific coast of Mexico, La Guatitlan in Guatemala, Bali. If you're in the market for a new best friend, I highly recommend finding one that lives in these kind of places. Just a pro tip. Anyways, she has a running joke that wherever she lives, it's always sunny, that the weather is not a topic of conversation for her because it's always perfect, and that all her main clothing options involve string. However, a few years ago, despite all this sun exposure, she had her vitamin D levels tested and they were low. So our body makes vitamin D when UVB radiation from the sun hits cholesterol molecules in our skin. Therefore, to make vitamin D, you need cholesterol and sun exposure on the skin. Vitamin D is actually not a vitamin at all. It's a hormone. And what hormones do is regulate our genes. They go into DNA and they turn on genes and they turn off genes and they make proteins, and those proteins do things in the body. Vitamin D is responsible for overseeing the production and function of 1,000 genes. It's like the CEO of a major organization. These genes do things from tryptophan metabolism, which is important for mood, REM sleep, immune regulation, and so on. Literally everything. And if you don't believe me, type vitamin D and whatever disease, condition, symptom you're interested in into PubMed search engine and watch the results unfold. So I, before this video, typed vitamin D into PubMed search and got 84,000 hits. And when I search for clinical trials, I see keywords like muscle strength, autoimmunity, asthma, dementia, all-cause mortality reduction, inflammatory bowel disease, and bone density. So vitamin D is critical for mood and mental health. But why did my best friend, who spends all day in the sun wearing strings, still have vitamin D deficiency? So there are a few reasons. Number one, we have variations in our DNA called SNPs that in some people may speed up the degradation of vitamin D, requiring them to consume higher levels. We also need magnesium to activate vitamin D, and about 40 to 60% of us don't get enough magnesium in our diets. This means it's important to take magnesium alongside your D to make sure you're actually absorbing and activating it. Three, my friend was vegan at the time of getting her D tested, and the vegan diet contains almost no cholesterol. So it's possible that my friend's cholesterol levels were actually low, meaning that the other key ingredient for making vitamin D besides sunlight was missing. So even if we're exposed to sunlight, it's possible that our vitamin D levels are not optimal. And like most other blood tests of vitamins and other markers, the reference ranges for D in blood are a little too wide for my taste. So in the reference ranges, being below 75 nanomoles per liter is considered low. However, I like to see my patients' D levels around 125 to 150 nanomoles per liter, which is the vitamin D sweet spot for decreasing all-cause mortality and cancer risk. So reducing death by taking vitamin D sounds like a good deal. If you're spending your days in the Northern Hemisphere, however, you probably need to supplement. And typically 1,000 IUs of vitamin D can get you into the sweet spot for optimal health. However, checking in on your levels at least once a year is a good idea to make sure you're absorbing, activating, and maintaining your D levels. Vitamin D is a fat-soluble nutrient. Therefore, I suggest taking it in drop form, which are suspended in fats like MCT oil or flaxseed oil, rather than those chalky white tablets, which are likely not as easily absorbed. You can also do something called bolus dosing your D. A study showed that if people were megadosed with 250,000 IUs of D at the start of winter, their levels shot up in 5 days and were maintained for 90 days after that. So for my patients who have a hard time remembering to take their supplements, I sometimes recommend they dose once a week, although it's preferable to take your supplement regularly to control blood levels. There's also some growing research on the link between vitamin D and sleep. We have receptors for vitamin D in the region of the brain that controls and regulates REM sleep. And there's a link between vitamin D deficiency and sleep apnea. And so anecdotally, my patients have reported noticing better sleep when taking their D at night. However, as a fat-soluble vitamin, D is stored, and therefore it shouldn't matter what time of day we take it. Although it doesn't hurt to take it before bed and see how your sleep improves. So there you have it. How are you doing your vitamin D this winter?